everyone. Good afternoon and welcome back to Bio 190. If you're just joining us for the first time, thanks so much for tuning in today. Hopefully you're able to find the broadcast okay. For those of you that are going to be watching this later on YouTube, it isn't live, but of course you're getting the same information, so that is always an option as well if you can't watch it live. It is always archived on YouTube. If you go to the new student section on Blackboard, it has all the information about how to get on there. So this is our second day of our exciting semester of Bio 190. Now, I understand that there are many of you that are not able to access Blackboard yet. We know that you are not being penalized in any way, shape, or form. All of the assignments, whether the quizzes, anything up there is going to stay up until everyone is active and has ample opportunity to do those assignments and take the quizzes. By next Monday, everyone should be on Blackboard, meaning you should have received from Cal State Dominguez-Hills staff an ID or a username and a password. If you are not able to log on by next Monday, and not before that, but next Monday, again, if you don't have that, you are welcome to email one of the staff members here at Cal State Dominguez-Hills, and his email will show up here on the screen shortly. So go ahead and write that down, washley@csudh.edu. And again, don't email before, but next Monday again if you don't have that information. As always, if you have any questions or concerns for me, you are welcome to email me as well at sswain@lbaop, and you'll see that email come up in just a few minutes as well. And then without further ado, as you guys know, I like to bring very special guests each and every Tuesday time they come here to Cal State Dominguez-Hills, and today I have one of my very good friends. As I did last week, we visited with Dave, and this week we have Milena. And Milena is one of the educators at the aquarium. In fact, she's in charge of this really big, cool truck we have, the Aquarium on Wheels. Yes. Just take a moment to talk about that, just because it's so neat.
Sure. It is a really cool program. It is our outreach program that we have at the aquarium, and what we have inside of the vehicle are live animals. So we take this big, huge truck that on the side, you know, it's colorful, it's got an octopus on the side, a shark on the other, and kids actually get to touch live animals after school. They get to do sharks and sea stars and anemones and all kinds of really cool California intertidal animals, so it's a lot of fun.
So we get to take the aquarium, kind of, to people that can't come to us, and so hence the name Aquarium on Wheels. So keep your eyes peeled for that guy on the freeways, because we do travel quite far, and so you might just see us, or maybe we'll come to your neighborhood sometime soon. So today we're going to be talking about fish, and fish is a very, very broad category, as we're about to dive into, that there are so many different kinds, thousands literally, of fish out there. So when we explore this today, we have to kind of keep our description of a fish very broad, because fish can mean a wide variety of things. And later in the broadcast, we have a really exciting opportunity to actually go virtually to the Aquarium of the Pacific today to take a look at some of the fish that we have there. And that's going to be taking place after our break today, so do make sure that you are around for that. So without further ado, I do want to start today with Kids Play Jeez on Freeway Go Swaps.
Well, that means it's a classification. If any of you remember back when you learned about, you know, what a kingdom was, what the phylum was, it's our way of giving us a little acronym to remember the different ways that we classify animals, which we call taxonomy. Today what we're going to be doing, as Sarah said, is we're going to stay really broad. We're going to go through the animal kingdom, go down through the phylums, the animals that have backbones, which are the chordates, and we're actually going to go and talk about fishes. Now, fish is really general, like Sarah mentioned, and under fish fall sharks. And we're not talking about those guys today, although they're really, really neat. We're only going to talk today about bony fishes, which means these are fishes that have true bones in their body, and you'll learn later on that sharks are not part of this family. They are actually cartilaginous fishes. So it's a really neat way in classifying animals, and what we're going to do today is we're only going to touch base a very small little bit of animals. And the reason why we have to stay broad and talking about fish is that bony fish in general are rule breakers. They don't follow these rules. They don't like, a fish has this, this, and this. You can't do that with these guys. They're so special, so amazing. So what we're going to do is talk about some of those amazing things on some of them and be as general as possible with the rest.
So where it starts to separate out is actually the class. So the kingdom, phylum, and then when we're getting down to class, is class osteic phase. And if you think of that ostea, the beginning of the word, you have osteoporosis, so that's where that bone comes in. So it's osteic phase, and that's that the bony fish versus chondric phase. And now those are your cartilaginous fish. So as Milena mentioned, your sharks and your rays and your skates. And then there's a whole other group of fish that we're not even going to get into because they're quite frankly very gross. And those are
cool.
They're cool. Yeah. The jawless fish. If you get an opportunity, go ahead and do a Google search for a lamprey or a hagfish. And just really kind of creepy. They have more slime than you can ever imagine. And then this is how they get away from their predators. And so that's that. We can talk about those guys alone for this the next half hour. But again, there are just so many fish to talk about, and so class osteic phase. You know, give us a sense of how many fish and how many found fish, because I'm sure there are many out there that we haven't found that described as of now. Are there in the world?
Yeah, there's about 18,000 fish that only fall under the category of osteic phase. So, I mean, you can imagine, we would have to be sitting here for hours, maybe days, to go through all of them. So it's a big, big group of fishes that we're just going to try and touch base on. So think about being a marine biologist. There's no way you could possibly know all of them. I certainly don't. I don't think Sarah does either. But it's really neat to just be able to take a chance and touch base on that small little cool group of animals of the 18,000 that are out there.
So I think that you've drilled home the point that it's very hard to define what a fish is. But we are now going to try, but we are probably going to use the word most, because that really is a key word when you're talking about fish. Most fish this, most fish that. And we'll really start with, when you look at a fish, you usually see fins. Do all fish have fins?
Well, no, they don't. And then not all fish have all the same kinds of fins. I mean, this is why we're talking about the rule breakers. Certain fish have body parts adapted that were fins that now look like a suction cup. But in general, the different types of fins that they will have, if you all remember, they're named very similarly to like a whale, like the dorsal fin. That's a big one. That's an important one. It's the one that they have, what we would consider the back of the fish, that would stick out of the body of the water. And we think that is sharks. The dorsal fin is another. The rectangle.
So you do have a diagram. Let's go ahead and bring that diagram up, Milena, as you're explaining that. There we go. And so we're just going to, as Milena goes through these, everyone, I'm going to just be pointing to some of the fins that she's talking about. And so these triangles here are the dorsals.
Those are the two dorsals. Some fish only have one dorsal, some have two, depending on the kind you're looking at. The one in the back, the tail fin is what people would call it. That's called the caudal fin. Towards the back. A lot of fish use this fin to swim forward. Right next to it on the bottom of that, we have the anal fin. You can guess why it's called the anal fin in terms of its location. And then we have the pelvic fin, which is kind of at the bottom. Now, in this diagram, it may be confusing. You may be thinking, oh, this thing is the other side of the pectoral, which is the one actually right on the little sides that stick out on some fish like little airplane wings. But this one is actually coming right out of what would be the chest of the fish. And each fin has a different purpose. And like I said, some fish live in, like we'll talk about, some fish live in different parts of the ocean. So some of them need certain fins while others don't. And while some of them have developed different properties to the fish, so it's going to be sort of a very interesting discussion when you talk about fins.
And with sharks, even, it's very different. And we'll talk about this more next week, but when we talk about sharks with Sabrina, but the dorsal fin, for example, is a fin that sharks can absolutely not live without, and they will die. But with some bony fish, not only is that not true, but a lot of times they can put the dorsal fin up, right, and then they can put it right back down. It will actually be flat.
Right, and that's the main difference between bony fish and cartilaginous fish is that the bony fish have the ability to do that, and then they have spines in there. They have spines on certain parts of the fins. That's why, you know, if you're talking fish. You can see they have little spots on their fins, while sharks is just sort of, it's a structure. It's rigid. It's very defined. And for a fish, it could just be just about anything.
Not only are those spines there, but a lot of times they're literally deadly. The stonefish, we'll see in a little bit later, has an amazing amount of toxin in those spines, in its dorsal fin, and that, again, is something you don't find in sharks. We are going to go ahead and show you our mystery item at this point. As you guys know, you are welcome to guess, and we will basically tell you if you're right or wrong. And it's a little bit tough today, hopefully, and unfortunately we can't zoom in any more than what you see right there,
because they are so small.
But let me give you a comparison. So there's the tip of the pin, just so you have something to compare it to. So go ahead, you are welcome to call us if you have a guess, or if you are on the chat board, of course you can send that. You see that phone number right there on the bottom of the screen if you do prefer to call. Now, scale certainly is something that we think of when we think of a fish. And if any of you have prepared a fish, you know that the scales get all over the place. So all fish must have scales.
No, not true. So this is why it's so confusing to people, right? But this is also why it makes them really cool. Not all fish have scales. Some of them actually have what we do, skin. Okay? And some of you might be just blown away by that fact. And I certainly was learning more about animals, just trying to understand a little bit about them. But some have skin very similar to ours. One of the main differences, obviously, between us and bears is that things can very easily pass through a fish's body. You know, that's how they regulate their water and salt intake. But some of the fish that do have scales, there's a variety of different kinds of scales that you can have. So they're not all exactly the same. So some have skin, some have scales, and even within those scales, the shapes of the scales are different. Some of them grow like concentric rings on a tree, while others just kind of get bigger and bigger. That's actually one of the ways that scientists age fish is through their scales. There's another true way to age it, and maybe we'll talk about that a little later.
Yeah. In fact, I have an interesting story about a fish that has skin in my aquarium. At home, I have sick fish right now. So I went to the fish store to try and get them some sort of antibiotic, and I was listing the fish that I have in there, and he said, "Oh, you can't use most of those antibiotics because you have scaleless fish." It's a clown loach. The clown loach has skin and not scales, just like our clean fish at the aquarium. So we'll talk about that a little bit more in a second. Angel shells is a guess coming in from Levi, and that is not a term that I'm familiar with, and so I do not think that's correct. It has nothing to do with a mollusk, and I will give you that clue today. So neither of those are correct, but it does look like we have a phone call coming in to the studio. So we have Richard. Hi, Richard.
Hi, how are you guys doing?
Good, how are you?
All right. What you just flashed up on the screen was equilibrium ears for a white sea bass. Am I correct?
Very good. Those are, more specifically, otoliths. Absolutely, otoliths, Richard. And so now we can talk about the other way that you do age fish. So Richard will be getting an extra credit point. Richard, what's the first letter of your last name?
Bay. B for Bagley.
What's that?
B for Bagley.
All right, perfect. Thank you so much for calling, Richard. Have a good afternoon. All right, so these are otoliths. So tell us a little bit about
These are really, really cool fins. That is the only true way to age a fish, and they're actually earbuds. Okay. A lot of fish use these to make sound and to hear. A lot of people don't understand that fish can actually hear. There's a whole family of fishes called the croakers, and there's a reason why they're called the croakers because they make noises in the water. And they use these earbuds, and they have enlarged earbones. To be able to hear each other and communicate. Now, obviously, they're not, you know, talking to each other, they're making noises and sounds. They do live in very murky water, so that's why they think that these animals have developed these large ear bones in their bodies. But what's really cool about them is that the only true way to gauge a fish is to take these ear bones and actually slice through them. And the way you do that is very similar, like you would take a cross section of it, like you would of a tree, and look at it, and you count the rings, the size of the rings, just like a tree trunk. You can tell a lot about a fish. There's a whole science behind otoliths, the showing them certain bulk otoliths. But unfortunately, the only way to get the otoliths is that you have to take it out of the fish. So this is actually one of the ways that they found out the oldest lived fish ever was many hundreds of years old. But of course, the only way they realized that is after they had killed the fish and taken the otoliths out. But it gives us a lot of really important information, like I said, migration patterns, temperature, salinity here, where this fish has been, lots of really neat science that's kind of up and coming before people.
Well, and really important science too, because, for example, if you're a fisherman, you might know that there are regulations of the halibut, and I don't know them specifically, so apologize for that, but let's pretend that you are not allowed to take a halibut home unless it's 12 inches long. Well, they know that a 12-inch halibut had already is X age because they were able to take the otoliths and find out, and then it had the ability to reproduce X amount of times. And so they say, okay, this one has given back to the halibut population enough where it can be removed from the ocean at this point. So these otoliths are not only A, cool, but B, really important in our future fisheries, which is a really big problem right now that we're overfishing the ocean. And so it is very unfortunate you have to kill the fish, of course, to find the age, but a really neat find there. Thank you, Richard. I'm assuming Richard is a student. So, Richard, if you are not, feel free to call and let us know that because you don't get an extra credit point if you are not a student. I don't know how to get an extra credit. How do you spell otolith? O-T-O-L-I-T-H. Is that correct?
Yes, otolith.
Rachel, what are some of the topics we can write about for the conservation paper? I would like to get started early. Is whaling okay? Rachel, I will, I'm not going to take some time to talk about that right now, but I will definitely post something on the Blackboard under the announcements to give you an idea of what would be okay for the conservation paper. So thanks so much for bringing that up. So we're moving right along. We did mention that that not all fish have scales. In fact, one fish, the bony fish, or the one bony fish you can touch at the aquarium, is the cling fish, and that's because they don't have scales. Right? If you touch a fish with scales, you can actually harm them. Right?
You will remove the scales, and you have scales are protective, so it's very harmful for them for you to do that. But all those fishes, the cling fishes, the entire family doesn't have it. And another one to think about is the moray eel. You know, it looks kind of weird, kind of creepy, kind of really cool. And, but it also doesn't have any scales. It actually has a skin. So take a look at that fish next time and you'll see that it just kind of looks different. You probably wonder, well, looks kind of weird. Well, the reason for it is just to see the scales.
Not a lot of touching with those guys going on, though, because they're deep. but they're very nice. I don't want to start any rumors that the gills are bad. Moving on to gills now. Surely all fish have gills, right?
Well, no. Some of them have the ability to breathe air out of the, you know, when you think about, oh my gosh, I'm blanking on this little guy's name. A mudskipper is a fish that actually has, in very basic terms, because we won't go crazy, get all scientific, don't do you guys, but it's almost like having little oxygen tanks inside of his body. He has the ability to breathe the air, but he also has the ability to breathe underwater. So fish have gills, but some of them have a little bit extra. Now, what's neat about fish, and a lot of people don't understand, is that they breathe oxygen. They're just removing the oxygen from the water. That's something really important to learn when you're talking about how the anatomy of the gill and what happens there. That they remove oxygen from the water. Now, gills on a bony fish are kind of different than a shark. They only have one gill opening. So you see one big kind of opening, closing. Usually on a fish, it's kind of on the side, you know, that it's doing something like this. And certain sharks and stuff, the sharks, they have lots of gill slits. So on bony fish, just one gill opening. While on sharks, it's a little different, 5 to 7, and we'll learn more about that later.
Yeah, absolutely. So big difference in the gills when you compare. And we could do a whole class on shark and bony fish comparison because they really are that different. While they're both fish, they are in such different categories. A few more things as we move along here. I want to go ahead and bring that graphic back up, if we can, of the fish to talk about the next thing here. It's called a lateral line. If you take a look at that fish there in the background, you will will see a line literally almost running from the head of this animal to its tail. Now, you won't see that on all fish, correct?
No, not all fish will have it, because this fish use this line that Sarah's facing right now for a free flow sort of person. For you to see is that this is how they sense each other. So schooling fishes will do this, but there are some fish that have absolutely no need to hang out with their buddies and figure out which way they're all moving together. So some of them lack the lateral line, or it's just not as effective as it is for some of those big school fish. It's important on some of those fishes that do hang out in aggregates or big schools, because this is how they sense the movement in the water. So they can sense some things moving around them, and this is how they're able to swim together.
And so when you see a school of fish, which we've probably seen on a movie or even Finding Nemo, if you think back to when they ran into that big school of fish, right, they can't catch transforming themselves into the arrow and then the opera house in Sydney, that while silly in a cartoon, but they don't run into each other very rarely unless one is sick or injured. How do they do that? And it's the lateral line. They are sensing the movement around them. And to oversimplify it, if Milana was a fish and all of a sudden she turned left, I would sense it in my lateral line. I would sense that water pressure difference around me, that movement, and somehow be able to transmit the idea into my brain and then enter in the same direction. So it really is quite complex. It looks just like a line, but there are very specialized cells that have nerves and so on connected to that line. Really interesting. A swim bladder is the next thing, and again, very different from sharks, but you may have seen a fish just floating in the middle of the water column. A lot of sharks, in fact, all sharks, would literally need to be moving or they will sink. And that's a whole different ball game, and it's not true that if they stop swimming, they will die. But what allows a fish to just float there without moving like a balloon?
So it's that swim bladder, also called a gas bladder, an air bladder. Whatever you call it, what's important for you is to understand what it does. And what it does is it aids buoyancy. Just like if you're sitting or swimming with your friends and you are at the pool and you take some water in and you breathe in, or you take some air into your lungs, you will go up. Well, as soon as you release the air, you see something kind of sink a little bit more down into the water. And that's essentially what's happening with these fishes, is they are taking air in order to go up, go down in the water column, so it aids in movement.
And there are some fish that don't have an air bladder, some bony fish specifically, and they do live on the bottom all of the time because they don't have the ability to fill that gas bladder, and so they can swim up into the water column using their fins, but eventually they will come down, back down to the ground because they're heavy and they don't have that regulation ability with the swim bladder. Cold-blooded, big difference obviously from mammals being warm-blooded. Fish are a cold-blooded species, cold-blooded mammal, not species. All species of fish are cold-blooded. And then of course the bony skeleton is another characteristic here as we move down. We are going to go backwards with that first characteristic we talked about, which are the fins. We are going to talk about this later in the broadcast, but we do want to show you just a brief video clip here to give you a sense of how different all of those fins are. So let's go ahead and cue up that little DVD clip we have, and as you watch some of the fish that are from the aquarium, Milana will show you, or tell you rather, what you're seeing here in this DVD. And again, the idea is...
So most fishes use their bodies to propel themselves forward. Most of them use the tail, as you see this Garibaldi kind of side to side going forward. But as you can see, this guy, he has more movement there with the dorsal, and this guy's doing absolutely nothing wrong because his fins are modified to do just that, kind of hold on to the bottom. They're more like hands than anything else. So this guy isn't doing very much swimming, a lot of eating, as you can see from that shot. He's floated down, that's our fly fish. And then there's this guy who just uses his pectorals to swim forward, and this is the family of wrasses that does this. You can see them there, just kind of pushing. It looks really awkward, but this is a characteristic of that family. So fins obviously function really important in fishing. You have fins to
And I think that that movie even showed you the importance of that swim bladder, because a wrasse is not going to be able to keep themselves out of the water column with those little pectoral fins. It's just not going to happen. So he's actually out there using that swim bladder, but propelling himself forward just barely using his pectoral fins. Again, we'll look at that with some live fish from the aquarium a little bit later. Body shape. shape it, and the fish we just need to use, especially in that special frog fish that was that creature who took a big bite at something, I'm not sure what he was going after. Bite fish certainly is very varied in the world of fish. We do have some questions here. Can we post a picture on Blackboard, please? I'm wondering, do we want a picture of an otolith? And if so, I can definitely put a picture of that on the Blackboard, and I'll make myself a note there.
Fish.
Pick up the fish. Certainly, I would love to do that. Unfortunately, I'm not sure exactly if you should fish, so if you could let me know, that'd be great. So, there are five basic fish shapes. One is very much like a football, that's the most common.
Right, it's called fusiform. And life serves as just like a football, you kind of taper to one end, taper to the other. And fusiform are typically what we think about, you know, they're really good swimmers, nice and streamlined, just like when you throw a football through the air. It travels very well, you know, the air kind of bounces off of the sides, just kind of rolls over, and the swimfish is swimming through the water. It's the same way, it really aids and it kind of sluts you through the water. The different fish shapes, they vary. There's five, as Sarah said, some of them like a pancake, some of them are super skinny, very skinny with. Some of them are kind of like a ribbon shaped, you know, if you think about eels, some are rod shapes, lots of different types out there. So it's important to look at fish shape. Shapes are important because it actually gives you a lot of information as to where the fish lives in the water.
So this animal in the background is a striped bass. You can see there, he has a very large mouth behind me. And a tuna is another picture that we have that really is a good example of that fusiform shaped fish. You get taper near the tail, taper near the head, very much if you shaved off all of the fins, pretended to anyways, and looked at the shape of the body, you would have a football shape. Very streamlined, very fast animal, very different from a flat fish. Clearly this tuna is going to need a lot of space to swim around. This is a kind of a strange perspective. You guys are looking at this guy, but think when you're scuba diving, you're snorkeling above him, and you're looking straight down onto the ocean floor. He literally is totally flat, like a pancake.
Yes, he is. He's a really interesting fish.
And obviously, he's not spending a lot of time up in the water column, called a depressed-shaped fish, so flat, living on the bottom, fusiform, depressed-shaped. An eel is called a ribbon shape. That's another one of those five fish shapes. Rod is the other one, and then compressed is the fifth one. You don't need to know all those five, but just to give you a sense of what they are, the names of them are. So you can tell a lot about a fish, and this is essentially how we teach our training at the aquarium. You can tell a lot about a fish, by looking at a few characteristics on its body. The first one is the shape. If you come to the aquarium, you see where a fish is hanging out, obviously, but also the shape. You can begin to paint a picture of what this fish is, what this fish's life is like. The second thing that really helps you is the mouth. If you take a look at a fish's mouth, it really gives you a sense of, obviously, what they eat, but again, where they live. And this first picture we have is of a butterfly fish. And if you just take a look at that mouth there, you're going to be able to deduce a lot of things. And clearly this guy isn't eating really big food, right?
Right. So this guy's feeding off little teeny tiny polyps, maybe some algae. These guys have little tiny brush-like teeth inside of their mouths. And you can see it's long and pointed. He's trying to get into tiny little spaces. Tells you a lot that maybe a coral reef is where this one would live, while some fish have huge mouths. Let's see an anglerfish here. I believe we have a picture of an anglerfish as well, just to show you that they run the whole gamut. And wow, that's a great fish. We also Finding Nemo. Remember that these guys live down at the deep. One of the different things about the movie and real life is that the movie, he was quite giant. In real life, these guys are inches long. While, you know, a clownfish and a pelican, you saw them as they were in Marlin, they can get about a foot long. But in reality, the anglerfish is very, very small. But you can see the mouth is really big. And the reason for it is that, why would you want a big mouth, right? You need to find your food.
Yeah.
And the problem is, it's really
in your own
life, and it's dark, and you can't find it. So when something does come along, you better have a big mouth to catch it. So that's why this guy's mouth is humongous, and you can see he's got a little fish on top of his head, so that he can bait somebody into, it's like a lure, just like going fishing. And these guys are like, that's why they're called anglers. They're anglerfishes, they're the true fishermen, they're fish that fish.
So, and it really does move back and forth, and again, referencing our amazing teaching tool that is fighting that big fleshy piece of tissue on the end of the fishing pole, quote unquote, actually bioluminescence, where it has the ability to make light. A lot of times there are bacteria that live in there that are doing the bioluminescence, and that, of course, is what attracts the prey to come over. And they say that these animals can even eat something that's 10 to 12 times the size of their own body.
Absolutely amazing.
So, again, you don't know when your meal's going to come next, even if it's 10 times the size of you, you better be able to eat it. A few of the other examples we have, we did show that mask that can come back up onto the screen. That guy had a really big mouth. And so even when animals are very small, anchovies, sardines are another example of schooling fish. They just open their mouth really big and they essentially swim through the water like that, correct?
Right.
And all those plankton, everything goes in, and that's it. That's how we eat.
Right. It's like walking around with your mouth open, hoping spaghetti will fly by the air. You know, it's just great. That would be very cool. So it's opportunistic to know that these animals live to eat, and to go to the bathroom later. Right? That's pretty much what they do. So you better be ready when something comes along to eat.
And then, of course, a few other examples. We've all seen a swordfish or a billfish before. Again, another form of eating, swimming into a huge school of fish, wrapping that sword side to side, disabling or injuring, even killing the fish, of course. Is the idea there. And then we will show you some more favorite pictures of puffer fish. Again, there, I think we're talking about mouths. Those are the ones that come to the forefront of my mind simply because their teeth are fascinatingly strong and a little bit scary. In fact, when our scuba divers are diving in our tropical reef exhibit at the aquarium, they're not worried about the sharks. They're not worried about some of the other fish, but they want to know where that big puffer fish is. Why is that?
Well, their teeth are fused together, so they don't have teeth like we have, of course, but it literally looks almost like a beak. And imagine a bird's beak attached to a fish and those powerful jaws they have. They could do some serious damage, you know, maybe possibly taking out the end of your finger, or even a whole finger. It's very powerful. So you have to be extremely careful when you're around. And like we said before, they're opportunistic. If you swing around, they're going to go for it. If your finger happens to be there, you better be careful.
So the three main mouth shapes, essentially, are pointing forward, and that's called terminal. Obviously, those animals are going to live somewhere in the water column, so they're actually going after food. That doesn't necessarily mean they're active predators. That butterfly fish, his mouth is facing forward, but he's getting really small fins, so he does have that terminal mouth. But that doesn't mean he's eating really big fish. But there are a lot of predators that have that terminal mouth, like the swordfish going straight for it. Of course, there are fish that have that mouth facing up. That frogfish we saw earlier, I call it the unhappy mouth face. I mean, it's this huge frown upside down, and so he's waiting for things to swim above him and just go after them.
Barracuda's another good example of the mouth pointing up. He's at the surface waiting for things to kind of come, small schools of fish.
And then, of course, that down-facing, it doesn't really have a better name than that, but a mouth that faces downward. Stingrays are a really good example of that. Clearly, they can't bring themselves up and eat something in the water column, so everything that they eat is coming from the bottom. So, again, point being that you can tell a lot about a fish just by looking at their mouth and the shape of their mouth, what they eat. Coloration is something that is actually not used at all, or shouldn't be, when you are classifying fish. So it would be actually very confusing if I sent you to the aquarium to look for the fish that had X coloration. If you go 3 months later, he could actually look a little bit different, right? And so this is very good to use, right?
Right. This is kind of the last defense when we are trying to identify animals. It's actually, like you said, something you should never really go by. Simply because fish change color. Fish can change color not only with age. Sometimes fish change sex as well. And they could be male one day and female another. We could talk about that later. But, you know, they could be blue as a girl and they could be purple as a boy. So it just really depends on the fishes. So you have to be very careful with coloration.
Now, this guy in the background, he doesn't change his color, but he is reliant on his color so much so that if he doesn't blend in, he's going to get eaten, right?
Absolutely. And as you can see from the picture, his whole purpose is to look like a plant, like something underwater, maybe some algae. because he needs to camouflage. So his coloration is intended, and you know, those are actual body parts to him. There are these appendages. It's you having an arm that looks like, you know, a leaf or something like that. And you know, the bush is a little bit old, like a leaf or something like that. So it's very interesting to see how these animals are able to camouflage. And this sea dragon is definitely one of the best ways for you to see just how amazing these fish can hide in their environment.
So certainly, if we're talking about camouflage, and that's one of my favorite animals, just so that maybe sea dragon, and just again, as a side note, my cousin, a sea horse, so they are the same family of fishes as a sea horse, a little bit different, but certainly similar enough. Now, this guy is considered one of the masters of camouflage with fish.
And yet, he's eating stonefish.
You might not even see what we're talking about right now because he's so good.
You can see this is what Sarah described as an unhappy face. There she is drawing it right there. That is his mouth. Right above are his eyes. And his body is just kind of looking like a big blobby rock. So this is his So right there you can see these animals are the masters of camouflage. Their whole purpose is to try and find food that comes by. They're ambush predators. They wait for something to come by and then they will go for it. So their best defense is that they will brainstorm.
And I think what's interesting is when we think of camouflage, we think of the prior two pictures that we've seen of really blending in of, oh, you can't see me because I look exactly like my background. But the next one we're going to show you is not necessarily specifically trying to blend in, but it is a form of camouflage. It's something that's very prevalent in sharks. So we're going to go ahead and go to that counter shading here. And so it's blending in, but in a very different way. So let's see that counter shading picture. This, just so you guys know, is that flatfish we talked about earlier. Again, a master at camouflage. Hopefully you can see the difference between the animal there and the sand, but they're very good at looking just like the sand. So explain to us how this guy thinks that he's camouflaging at all.
Right, so this is called counter shading. And what this is he's trying to confuse his predators into thinking that he's not really even there. If you notice, this great white shark is very white on the bottom, very dark on the top. If you were swimming underneath this guy and looking up, you can see the sun is up above shining down onto him. Well, the white side will really blend into the light that is coming down from the sun into the water. If you were on the opposite side of him on top and you were looking down, at the bottom of the ocean is clearly darker. As you get deeper, it gets darker. And the top side of his body will blend in with the deep, dark bottom of the ocean. So it's an excellent way to hide.
Yeah, absolutely. So again, looking up, big bright sun, and it looks the same as his belly. Schooling fish, surprisingly enough, plain old silver guy, sardine, anchovy. Maybe you've seen this from a boat or from a dock. A big school of fish moves underneath, and occasionally you just see a little shimmer. It looks as if something down there is wearing a big diamond ring or a big piece of silver jewelry, and that, in fact, surprisingly enough, it may encourage the birds to come over and eat them, but it actually confuses the predators a little bit, right? And so in a sense, that coloration is helping them.
Right, so the coloration, when they're like that, they appear to be something large, too, which is also really helpful. If they're all very similar in color, then they're just a big, giant mass, and a predator may not understand that it's a bunch of small little fishes. Instead, they confuse it for one large animal, and maybe we'll go for it.
Essentially, safety in numbers, right? And our sharks do that. In Shark Lagoon, the bamboo sharks, we get a lot of questions out there. Why are they laying on top of each other? They're just constantly in the same clump. And again, safety in numbers. If you were a predator looking at them from above, you might think they're one giant shark instead of lots of little sharks. The surgeon fish and rabbit fish, you're going to see here next. Another form of camouflage, again, very disruptive. And these guys aren't even the king and queen of it. We have some trigger fish that you just want to see what is going on your body. But it can help confuse predators a little bit, right?
Right. A lot of animals in the ocean, if they are brightly colored and they are not essentially, to put it very basically, afraid to be seen, they are usually venomous. And so that's what these guys are doing. They have bright colors and they truly are venomous. The surgeon fish on the bottom side of the picture here, the two little orange dots toward the base of his tail, Sarah will point them out for you right now. Right in there, there's actually a venom inside of there. The rabbit fish has venom in his spines that are located all over his body. So it's a warning. It's, I'm bright, I'm colorful, you should be afraid of me.
And this guy, this nice guy, thinks that he's doing that, but the big difference is that he actually has no venom.
Yeah, none at all. And this is probably our California state marine fish, the Garibaldi. And he is kind of a weirdo in the middle of our browns and greens and berries that we have here in California. He's bright orange. And the reason we believe that they might be this way is that they are trying to mimic as if they are venomous. They are saying, look at me, I'm bright, I'm orange, shouldn't you be afraid of me? Are you really going to eat me because I'm bright orange? Don't you worry, I might have some sort of venom in there. So that's the whole point. It's, they're tricking them. To think there's something of them since I don't know.
And as a side note, not only that, but they are in a family of fishes that's known as being very aggressive. They're kind of damselfish. More specifically, these guys are very aggressive. Maybe you've had an encounter with them. I know Milena has that of... They are in your face.
They are. And I've been swimming there in Catalina, and they're very territorial. So when they have a nest of eggs, this is my space. I don't care how big you are, what you look like. I'm going to protect you. And I had one picking at my mask because it got way too close to its nest. So clearly, I am a lot bigger than, you know, at most these guys are probably about 14 inches long. But they didn't care. They were going to go after me, or he was. He was protecting his nest, and he was attacking me. And it's not like it's good.
So that... No,
I didn't hear it.
So that gives you, in a nutshell, just the wide variety of the reasons that fish have the colors that they do, and we just barely see on the surface, but it gives you a sense that it's not always trying to blend in. Again, this Garibaldi lives in a very brown, drab world, but it, over time, has developed the need, in its opinion, to be orange. And it's rampant all over the ocean of just very interesting reasons that animals have the colors that they do. We touched very briefly earlier on fish senses, and I think you mentioned that it was strange that fish have the ability to smell. And so let's go ahead and just go through our five senses very, very quickly. One is the ability to smell, and they do have that ability. I think I found when explaining that, especially to kids, that if you're underwater and you try and smell, quote unquote, through your nose, it's not going to end well. You're going to be in a lot of pain. Very different for fish that doesn't have it, but they can smell.
Absolutely. They have specialized structures, or we would call them those. Instead, they're called nares. Some fish have them right at the front, like we call turtle. Some fish have them up towards the top. Depends on where they live in the water. Where they're trying to smell their food, that's essentially what it's for them to smell their food, to smell if somebody's coming.
Ears. They don't have big ears like us, or ears that you can see externally, rather, but they do have the ability to hear. In fact, some of them can hear a lot farther than you realize. The same is true for sharks. They can hear better than any of their other senses. Eyes. Thus far in the program, you've probably deduced that all fish have eyes, but that is actually not true. In fact, the fish that you see here in the background does not have the ability to see.
This guy's called Dave Fish, and you can tell by his name, he lives in very dark spaces where there is actually no need for eyes. So, again, rule breakers, but an amazing animal. You should definitely Google this guy, too, and you will see that this animal has no need to see anything. It relies completely on the other senses of smell, of taste, of course, to find its food, but has no need for sight.
And then, of course, touch and taste are the last few. And you can see again there a picture of a cavefish in the background. Touching is clear when they rub up against the rock, or, you know, they have the ability to touch just like you and I. But depending on who you ask, and you may know if that's been decided, but the lateral line lies within the world of touch, right? Because it is kind of touching. It's not its own sense, but I think in the world of ichthyology or the study of fish, lateral line is grouped in that touch,
right? Absolutely, yes.
And the last one is taste. And this cavefish actually helps us explain this a little bit better, that when we want to taste something, obviously the food has to go in our mouth. But that's not true. Let's go back to that cavefish. A lot of fish have these appendages that are coming out of their mouths. More specifically, that was really fast. They're called barbels. So he's tasting with those little appendages.
Can you imagine if you had little, long, skinny tongues sticking out of your chin? That's essentially what this guy has. what he does is he's tasting things before he gets his mouth on it, maybe sifting through the bottom, just trying to find some food. So I think that would kind of be easy enough to open your mouth to greet somebody.
Alright, we are going to take a break. When we come back, we're going to be joined by some staff at the Aquarium of the Pacific, taking a close look at some really neat fish that we have there. And we'll see you guys in just about 6 minutes.
Hey, what's up? I'm Nicole Aaron.
And I'm Shayna, and you guys are watching University TV.
Today we're at California State University in Topeka,
home of the tour of
China's next campus tour.
Entertainment centers and attractions.
She's out of the very niche to go to the Southern California is one. Pretty much always warm here. We have other things.
The Parkland City of the Cal State Municipal Campus sits on 346 acres, providing plenty of places to stay or lounge outside and enjoy the California weather. All clubs are only a short walking distance from one another. You'll also find pedestrian paths lined by eucalyptus or other shade trees.
Known as the college on the hill, the campus makes good use of the terrain, with many buildings built at varying elevations. The campus is made only through second story walls, buildings, and bridge walkways provide a seamless connection.
So this is basically because you want the safest city in the system. It's amazing for cities and beautiful things to go very, very popular.
This university enrolls about 12,000 students per semester and is one of the most ethnically, culturally rich student bodies in the U.S. No one ethnic group on campus is in the majority. The student body is 70% female to 30% male.
Well, after graduating high school, I had quite an opportunity to visit the school and I decided to come here. I want to be a teacher in California, so that's one of the best teaching programs for teaching prevention. We talk about the classroom system, and that's one of the main things that pulled me here.
Students are now seeing safe decisions. Awesome of our students have a specific GPA requirement that corresponds with an SAT or ACT score. The higher your GPA, the less we can put on the score. The lower the GPA, the lower the stronger that makes me.
Students with GPAs below 2.0 are not eligible for admission.
For California residents, the average total time to attend university is $3,400, not including the cost of books or housing. Out-of-state students pay about $400 extra per unit. The university offers many financial aid options, including scholarships and grants.
Cal State's biggest institution awards choice of 45 bachelor's, 21 master's degrees, and 10 teaching grant certificate programs. Some of the students' favorite majors include legal studies, business administration, digital media arts, child development, and nursing.
Want to work in television or the motion picture or music industries? Cal State Topeka's Digital Media Arts program successfully prepares students for careers in those fields.
The legend holds true. There's a ghost in every theater. The Dominguez Hill Spirit comes to every play, opens the elevator doors, and wishes the cast good luck.
The university also has the largest master's degree program in conflict resolution and peacebuilding. Plus, the orthotics and prosthetics program is one of only 7 such programs in the nation.
With 687 faculty members, the university has a student to faculty ratio of 23-1.
The university has 11 men's and women's girls athletic teams, including the NCAA Division II level.
The girls go 3 conference titles and 3 national championships. Our students have Cal State's system, like most college residents, halls or dormitories. The complex consists of 22 two-story buildings with 1, 2, and 3 bedroom furnished apartments, all with full kitchens. resort built house at the 1984 Summer Olympics.
I do currently live in Campus Albuquerque, it's a nice experience. I don't have mom here to tell me what to do, but also it gives me the opportunity to interact with people on a variety of different settings
to meet students concerned from 60 student-run groups usually or participate in from cultural special interest organizations to professional service and honor society groups. There are also 5 fraternities and 8 sororities on campus, some of whose origins have Latino or African-American beginnings.
There's a lot of issues to be involved in, obviously involving collective organizations for our church. But we love these guys, you know, we're adults all the time.
Addicted to reality TV? Well, here's your reason to get off the couch. The Associate Students Cooperative put activities together for you every year. Today, the Amazing Race.
Dan Reset, a pianist composer who has worked with people like Bernie Hancock and Prince, BC Nash, actors whose television credits include Reno 911 and Clean House, and John Langley, the co-creator and executive producer of classically entertaining Cops.
Under first, or I think would be Home, because it is Home.
If you're looking for a friendly student folks university where you won't get lost and it seems like everyone knows your name, be sure to check out Cal State Dominguez Hills in the heart of beautiful Southern California.
Thanks for joining us here in Carson, California,
on our campus tour of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Bye. Alright, welcome back. Hopefully you guys had a good little break there, and we are back here to talk a little bit more about fish. And we do have another mystery item that we will reveal here in a little while. So without further ado, we do want to connect with the Aquarium of the Pacific, more specifically, more friends of mine. I have lots of friends. I'm just kidding. Catherine Fox and Emily Yam are there, and they are in front of the exhibit we have called the Tropical Pacific Preview. And that is as it sounds, it is a preview of our big tropical gallery. So you can see many, many fish swimming there in the background. And we have Catherine. Hi, Catherine.
Hi, Elena.
How are things there at Trop Preview?
They're going swimming. There are lots of fish. They just had their feeding, so you can see they're quite active, moving around, doing a lot of swimming and showing off for us.
All right, perfect. So, Yelena would like to get the opportunity to talk about a few of the fish in there. Yelena, before we talk about specifics, though, can you tell us what the main characteristics, and I guess more specifically, I'm just noticing because I do work there, but the color. We talked earlier about the color, that we see a lot of color in the picture right now.
Right. In the tropics, in the warmer waters, there's a lot more color in the animals, a lot of browns and grays and greens are picked out here in Southern California. As you can see from the photo, from the video, there's whites and yellows and blues and even some reds and oranges, hopefully, that we'll have the opportunity to see. There's just a lot of beautiful coloration in the tropical animals.
So, Catherine, we have been talking a lot today about Finding Nemo, just because we all know that it's a great teaching tool. So let's go ahead and see if we can find one of those movie stars there in that exhibit. And we may know her as Dory, but actually there's a little bit of a pet peeve of ours at the aquarium that this animal has more of a name than Dory, right, Elena?
Right. This is called a palatine. Also another common name is a royal tang. And it is that blue that you see in the picture, also with a little bit of a yellow towards the tail. These fish are pretty amazing in terms of they actually have venom in their bodies. They do have one towards the base of their tail. Their family name is, Catherine's trying to chase after them there. Their family name is a surgeon fish because they do have those scales kind of in the backs of their bodies, which you can see. They do a lot of movement with the pectorals, and those are moving around there, a little bit of yellow in the tips. They ever so often do that caudal fin, which is the tail fin, to get around.
Now, while they look totally different, they actually have kind of a quote-unquote, not a true cousin, but in the same family of fishes, right? And that's the uniform fish. It's similar because of those spines you mentioned.
Right. The uniform fish are a little different because they actually have two on each side. Of the total of four, you see my skull unicorn fish? He's got this big thing plastic hat is in there. He truly does look like a unicorn with me, but they are of the same family, even though they kind of look a little different. But you can definitely see when you look for those scalpels or those blades, and that's how you know it's a surgeon fish. So you can tell he's definitely moving a lot more with his tail fin, his paddle fin there to get around. So it's not very specific to the family. Although his pectorals, he can see using them to swim, but from far away it's difficult to tell because they're a little bit see-through-ish. So it's a bit, they are kind of moving them when they need to, but he's mostly using his paddle fin to get around.
And last but not least, Catherine, we have a very special big yellow fish in there, and I know that you said he's playing a little bit of a game of hide and seek with you. Is he there?
Yes, he is, as we speak.
So there he is, and that is our awesome, awesome puffer fish right there. He's yellow, beautiful, vibrant yellow with little black dots on him. And you can see this guy is swimming with a dorsal and an anal fin. It's actually his second dorsal there. There he's gone out of the picture. But you can see they have a very interesting looking body, kind of like a big bubble. And they do puff up. When you think about a puffer fish, you all remember from Finding Nemo. They have those are porcupine puffers in that movie. This guy is a different family. It's called a true puffer. Some of them have those spines that we know when we think about a puffer fish, and others don't. And those are the ones that you were looking at here. It's just a different type.
Alright, cool. Well, that gives us an idea. Clearly there are more than three species of fish in that exhibit. And Catherine, if you can hear me, we want to say goodbye to you guys. Our fish are gone, but I know that you can still hear me, right?
Yeah. Alright, Sarah, thanks very much for visiting the aquarium today.
Alright, bye-bye. So we have many species in that tank, and again, it just gives you a sense of how many different kinds of fish there are out there, and it, by no means do any of us know all of those specifically. We try, but it is very, very hard. Excuse me while I just take off this microphone, because I don't need that one anymore. So we are going to now get into the world of fish reproduction, and it is a very interesting world. Again, along with a lot of things we've been talking about thus far, that one would think that, okay, all fish actually reproduce in the same way and mammals do, and so that's, I think, the way that we think, but that is not true in the world of fish at all. So let's start with actually the most common, and that's when it goes spawning.
Right. Spawning has to do with just the release of eggs and sperm into the water, and broadcast spawning simply because you are just simply releasing those into the water and hoping that they will join up together, and then you will have a viable offspring right there. So this is kind of an interesting way to reproduce. It's not at all that successful, which is why when they do broadcast spawn, they release a lot out there into the water. And we can see from the picture behind this what that kind of looks like. It's a big cloud. You know, there are sperm in the water, eggs in the water. And these fish are kind of like having a big get together and ensuring that they're in a very small space in order to have a good success rate of a viable offspring there that eventually will become, some of them will become plankton and actually drift off and then eventually turn into what we recognize as a fish. But this hopefully will increase the odds of survival, having a lot more of them out there.
And when you say a lot, there is actually one fish that kind of wins the category of having the most eggs, right? And that's a big one that lives right here.
Right, it's the mola mola, which is also called the ocean sunfish. It is a giant animal, I think 10 or 11 feet from gigantic. And I can't forget the millions, is it?
I don't even remember. It's something, it's thousands for sure. So, millions is not a lot. It's not, we're not talking 10, 20 eggs. It literally is thousands. And so, that's another fish that I want you to Google because it's one of my favorites. So, I think you have three that you have to Google now. And that's an ocean sunfish. Really, really neat animal. And so, what you see there in the background is obviously a growing baby, and they're called fish fry. when they are babies. What's neat is that they're still considered plankton when they're that small. If you take a look down at your pinky fingernail, they are no bigger than that. In fact, sometimes even smaller. And plankton, remember, means that animals that are at the mercy of the currents are floating and drifting around in the sea. These guys are just too small. They're not swimming against the current, so they're still considered plankton.
Right, they are, yeah.
And they're just very small, and until they grow up, they are not that nectin that we talked about last week. If you are a fisherman, then maybe spawning is something you're familiar with in the sense that a lot of times all these fish are coming from far and wide, and a lot of times it's temperature cues, it's the moon, the lunar cycle. So a high tide, maybe in a full moon, indicates, okay, it's time to go, let's all meet at that mud flat. And they really do have sand flats, so the sand bass, right? They meet over these big sand flats. And that's when the fishermen a lot of times will go to those sand flats as an opportunity to catch up the fish that are spawning there. Another form that we have a picture of here in the background, I know at first glance you're probably thinking, what is that? But an animal actually did make this amazing, amazing thing, and that's a little baby skate, right? I'm not talking about those guys today, but it's a form of angling, right?
Right, so essentially what we see when it's peeled off, and you can actually see the edges of some of its fingertips, is that this piece is made by the female animal. And it literally is an egg case. It's an egg layer, and inside of the case is the animal. And when this animal, with its own yolk sac, is attached to you, just like a chicken egg yolk, would be attached to the umbilical of this animal, when it is ready, big enough, gross enough, and will actually hatch out of the egg. So it's very interesting way that sharks and skates race do this.
So bony fish also have the ability to lay eggs, but it doesn't look anything like that. So the Garibaldi is one that you mentioned earlier. You talked about it defending its nest. So it's not a broadcast spawner, but the eggs are actually in a concentrated place.
Right. So if you think about what a little small batch of eggs would look like, they will lay the eggs, the male and the female, depending on the species. Sometimes it's the male who does that. Sometimes it's the female. And the eggs will live in this nest and be protected by them until they are ready to hatch. So,
some of the other really neat places that fish will actually keep them, one is in their mouth. These guys are called mouth brooders. And there's one fish in the aquarium called the Bangai cardinal fish. And I do believe, correct me if I'm wrong, that they get fertilized, right? And then he picks them up and he keeps them in his mouth, right? During this time, does he eat?
Not typically. I don't believe that
they do. I don't think they do either. So there's a big mouthful of babies.
Right, and that's kind of neat. As you can imagine, just having that in there. And a lot of species of fish, it's also a very dangerous time because even when your young does hatch and it does, come out of your mouth and just is out there, you have to very quickly kind of try and recover from that. So a lot of fish, it's a very sensitive time. Immediately after the fish leaves the mouth, which is such a weird time, very strange.
One I think that might be even a little bit more strange, though, is there's one species, and I forget its name, but it actually has this big hook on the top of its head, and somehow it manages to get the eggs under the hook, and the hook just holds it there on the top of the head. I read about that guy recently when I was doing some research for the fish tree. So these are brooders, basically, of brooding or holding their eggs in different places. And then, of course, you may know about the sea wars with their brood pouch or holding them up there against their body. A mermaid's purse, yes, Levi, absolutely. What you see there in the background is called a mermaid's purse. It basically, I guess, to someone in the past looked like a little brown purse. And it does often have big old tendrils, as they're called, and those get wrapped around the algae, and so the mother lays the egg case, and so the name that looks like purse straps. Live birth is certainly a mammalian characteristic, so we think of that as one being very common, but in fact it's very uncommon in the world of bony fish, but it does happen,
right? It's a very small percentage of fishes that do this, but animals like the surf perches are definitely an example of live birth. They give live birth. It looks very interesting, specifically for certain species of them. They're born tail first, kind of coming out, and then just successively one right after the other. If you're not, and with any other animals, if you're not careful, it's tame mates. It might be an opportunity for a lot of other guys to get a little bit of a feast there. But they do give live birth, which is absolutely phenomenal.
And perch are very common here in Southern California. There are surf perch, sea bush perch, I forget all the other kinds. Dave will come in at me. Shiner, thank you. Between the two of us. They give live birth, and we actually have quite a few of them at the aquarium. And so I have had the opportunity to see them give live birth, and they are little miniature versions ready to go. They come out, and there's no parental care. They're just ready to go, eat their food. And they are surprisingly large compared to the mom's body. That when I saw it, I don't know about you, but it was, where was she putting all those babies?
Right. No, absolutely. I saw a fish that was maybe a couple of inches long, literally 2 inches long, give birth to about 10 small ones that were maybe like a little less than half an inch. I mean, how is that possible? But it makes for a very interesting and good success rate. They completely see that larval stage. That stage where we talked about the broadcast spawners, the potential for other animals eating those eggs is huge. Also, when you spawn, which is why spawn so many of them, here we miss that. And like Sarah said, they're ready to go, they're ready to swim, they're ready to go find their food. And they just need full of these perfect little fish that are have a really good, like I said, success rate. And in the ocean, they're able to kind of escape out of that area that might be potentially dangerous for them and maybe go hide out in California in the kelp forest. It's a great place for those small little birds to start their life out, get a little bit of a shelter before they're ready to go out and grow bigger and get the bigger, big pieces of food.
And it's not very common, so I think it's neat that we have one of the few species here in Southern California that actually does give live birth. So those are a few of the reproductive practices. But we did talk earlier about when we were in the world of color, Milena mentioned something about fish have the ability to change their sex, and that was not a joke. It is true. And we do have a species here in Southern California that actually has the ability to do that. It is not all that uncommon, though. There are very many fish species worldwide that have the ability to change their sex. And this guy, tell us the story.
This is a very neat fish. It's called a sheephead, a California sheephead. And what you're looking at right now is the male version of this fish. You will notice it has kind of a little sandwich of dark towards the back of his body. His head is very dark, and the middle is bright pink, and he's got a white chin. Well, what happens is that all of these animals are born female. They will change sex when a dominant male will die. And then they will have what we call the big mouth competition, which I know Sarah and I love to do better. We're teaching people about this because it's absolutely a crazy method of determining who will change sex. And say Sarah and I are two dominant females, which we are. And what we want to do is we want to fight for the power to have control over we want to be more each one of us. So what we'll do is have the big mouth contest. What we literally will do is open our mouths big enough, as big as possible, kind of like Sarah's right now. And whoever has the bigger mouth is essentially the one who gets to change into the male. It's showing dominance. So you'll see these two fish with their mouths wide open, kind of having a little, you know, competition. We do this with kids. We do this even with teachers to kind of have kids, other teachers teach other kids about how it works and how the dynamics of a harem would be, and how important it is to have that balance, and it's important to them, and it truly is a competition. If you become the male, you essentially have that power.
And so there are no baby boy sheephens, right? They're all girls.
They're all girls.
And some change, and some don't. So they just stay girls their whole lives. Now, we do have a very big boy sheephead in our Blue Cavern exhibit, but there are a few females in there, one of which is changing. And again, these are social cues, and usually it's when the boy is gone. But maybe they know more than we do. I often wonder this, but does she know that he's old, that he's going to die? I don't know. Why is she changing in that exhibit? And so it's fairly well understood, but there still are a lot of questions. And generally, it's that social cue of the boy is missing, turn to the girl, and turn to the boy from the girl. But it's not always that direction. In fact, there's a species for its opposites from the boy to the girl, right? So the clownfish is an example of that. They actually go the other direction. There's actually even some fish that will jump back and forth. So it's not that, don't take this to heart, that they all start out as females and then turn into males. Some of them, it's the other way around. We have an entire exhibit at our aquarium, and I've seen definitely other exhibits and other aquariums around the world that show this and kind of show the difference in species that do this. The big bass family, the ones that we said swim with their pectorals kind of swim like this. The sheephead is definitely an example of one of them, and what you're looking at behind me is the female. All the females are pink. So this is where we also wrap into coloration and how it's not, you shouldn't pay too much attention to identifying that this is actually an example where you can, because all of the females are pink with a little white chin, and all of the males, the few that there are, have a black tail and a black head and a beak in the middle.
The first picture we saw. I do want to try and do one more mystery item if we can. We may be zoomed in a little bit close, so let me just put that out there for our lovely staff that are operating the cameras while we move forward. If we can get a picture of the male anglerfish, we skipped over that earlier, but while we're here in the world of reproduction, this is something that is not to be missed. If you thought sex change was a crazy story, wait until you hear about these anglerfish. Now, Milana talked earlier about anglerfish. We think of them as really, really big, but in fact, most of them are small. When we say small, the boys typically are smaller than the girls, right? And once we get a picture, you'll see, again, how just beautiful these fish are. But before we get that picture up, just give us a sec. Well, tell us the story of anglerfish reproduction.
Right, so the way this works is isn't she cute? When you live in a world where it's dark, it's cold, and the chance of survival is very slim on your own, you want to make sure that you ensure the survival of your species. So this is an example of how much smaller the males will be. The males aren't even smaller than the females, so we're talking a couple of inches for the female and maybe even half an inch or less for the male. What happens, and this is where the story is crazy, as Sarah said, is that the males will find the female, and when they finally do, they will grab on, and they will latch on for dear life. I am not going to let you go, woman. I need you. And they really do, because this is, again, the survival of their species. And what they do is they literally will latch on, almost like if I were to take my head of Sarah and stick onto her arm. They will attach
for the rest of my life.
For the rest of her life, I will essentially be attached to her, and I will rely on her for food. All my nutrition, they even actually will attach and get a little bit of their blood supply, will go through to these two animals, and then the sole purpose of the male is simply to supply sperm. And that is why he's there, and he's happy to be there, because he needs her to survive. He's way too small to be out there in the ocean, in the deep ocean, trying to find food and all that. So they will latch on, or he will latch on to her and stay there for the rest of his life, supplying sperm. Well, she in turn will supply nutrition for him, and eggs, and in turn to reproduce.
So again, it's not only not knowing when you're going to find your next meal, and that was that 10 to 12 times larger fun fact that we shared earlier, but it's not knowing when you're going to be able to find another of your same species to be able to reproduce, to continue to grow your species. When you live in the dark, it's quite honestly hard to find a boyfriend. Love over it. We think it's hard here of where we can see each other. Imagine down there. And so they've been able to circumvent that. So they attach to each other. I don't know that I recommend that, but that is the world of anglerfish. We are going to go ahead and jump to, I don't know if we can get a picture of our next mystery item. If we can't, that's okay, but if we can't, let it just appear as it just did. So this is our next mystery item, and I will let you compare that again to a pin. And there is, so go ahead and chat on the chat board. If you are a student, you are welcome to call into the studio or send a message through that chat board if you want to guess. Before we leave the world of reproduction, we have salmon. So this is not an example of a marine species, but again, a very fascinating creature. It's a freshwater, well, actually, you can see that those wolves, it's freshwater and saltwater. But tell us a little bit about a salmon. What do they do?
Well, what they do is kind of interesting. It's that, like you said, they're both fresh and saltwater, simply because they can live their life in both. Now, what's interesting about them is that they have the ability to live in the saltwater and regulate, you know, all the craziness that happens with having to live there. And then when they are ready to reproduce, they will actually swim up, hang out in what we call brackish water, which is a combination of kind of salty, half mixed with fresh. And then they will actually swim up into fresh water, up rivers and streams, in order to spawn. So it's a very interesting ability to even be able to survive in both types of water. That is very, very difficult for fish to do. They have to balance the amount of water and salt inside of their body. But these guys will swim upstream in order to release their eggs and spawn together. And they will migrate up to do this together, which is for a very interesting journey. Very difficult. There's a lot of salmon farms nowadays because it's a lot of their path to get where they needed to go is blocked by development and things like that. So it's very important to understand the salmon you get at your plate, you know, wherever you go at a restaurant. It's important to know where it came from. It's important to understand what salmon have to go through in order to reproduce.
All right, really quickly before we get to full year of Fort Warren, we have a lot of guests. We have some eels again, we have sea snakes, we have a sea creek. So Corey is coming in with the word sea creek, which I like. That is the closest answer that I see so far, but I do want a little bit more of a specific answer. I see water snake, the skin, and that is pretty darn close as well. So again, water snake and sea creek, key terms there, but we don't have the specific answer yet, but we do have a call coming in. Who do we have calling us today? Hi, Hector. Hector, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Hey, Hector, are you a student?
Yes.
All right, perfect. So what is your guess?
My guess is a water snake skin.
You are right, but we are looking for a little bit more specific. So the specific sea or water snake or sea creek. So definitely do a little bit more research if you can and give us a call back. All right, thanks for calling, Hector. With the salmon, we have a yellow-lipped sea creek, and that is not the answer. Nice try, Rachel, but it's not a yellow-lipped sea creek. So we've talked about during reproductive times, fish can definitely change their color, but salmon can even change their mouth, like a lot more than their color changes. I think it's the summer salmon, I forget which one, but they are just hideous. Before they reproduce, they get this big, long hook on the underside. I think that's the boy specifically, but woo! All right, banded sea crane. Yes, Marissa, excellent job. This is a banded sea crane. Are banded sea cranes a fish, Milena?
Banded sea cranes are actually a very special, kind of weird animal that technically lives in the ocean all the time. Their body is more adapted to be underwater. If you look at a live picture of these, probably some of you that were looking them up, they actually have a tail. Just like a fish, it's like a paddle. It's very interesting.
So yeah, it's not, it's like a circle, right? It's like awesome. So they are still reptile though, but they are living in the ocean, so one might think so a fish, but they do reside within the ocean. Okay, so we're going to highlight just a few species of tropical versus temperate. And what does that mean first before we get there? Tropical, obviously meaning warm water. Temperate, more like our Southern California location. Quite honestly, it means just a little bit chillier than tropical. And if you've been to the ocean lately, you might know what temperate feels like. I personally am a big baby these days. I used to just be running right into the ocean. Now it feels so darn cold. So let's start with a tropical species. And we picked between the two of us some of our favorites.
Right.
And parrotfish is definitely one. So before we see that movie, let's go ahead and see a picture. And there he is.
Right.
And you've got some fun facts about
this. I do. Now, we've been talking about three of Sarah's favorite. Now we finally have about my absolute favorite. This right here is a parrotfish, and you can definitely tell by the front of his mouth, and you'll see this a little bit later in the video. They literally look like a parrot. They have these teeth that are kind of fused together, very strong and powerful, but very colorful fish. Really, this you see Google's crows, grains, there's so many different species of parrotfish, and they all are very lively colored. Now, what you see in the picture, that is the really, really cool part, and this is why I love to talk about this fish with kids, is that it's difficult to see in the photo, but what this guy is doing is he settled himself at the bottom of the ocean, and what he has done is made himself a little protective layer. Now, what the layer is made out of is the crazy part. It is actually made out of mucus. That's right, snot, glitter, snot, whatever you want to call it. It is a mucus layer that essentially blows almost like a cocoon balloon. It's surrounding him, but it's see-through with his mucus. And what this is doing, it is allowing, or not allowing anybody to smell him. And so if an animal were to come by, maybe a fish, a predator, would swim right above him, or her, and wouldn't be able to smell this fishy smell that comes out of their bodies, and they can rest comfortably at the bottom of the ocean at night and not worry about getting snatched up or eaten.
And so this mucus comes from their mares, right? So and it kind of just flows back onto their body until it is essentially enveloped.
Right. So it's like, imagine if you put yourself in a bubble. You blew a giant snot bubble, right?
One question I have, I don't know if I can answer, but are parrotfish particularly smelly? That why do they need a mucus thing? But I get other fish don't. But do they have a scent that is just really easily
ridiculous? I don't know why them and not anybody else. So I'm sure they don't ask themselves, so who cares that I've got this really easy.
I've also heard the rumor that things get stuck to the mucus throughout the evening, so water maybe is flowing and plankton and humane is getting stuck to the mucus, and then they eat it. They come out of there. Have you heard that too?
Yes.
That is gross. They come out of their mucus sleeping bag and they eat it because all those creatures are stuck to the mucus.
Right, absolutely. And this is why this is one of the coolest fish in the year. You can talk about mucus with children, and it is exciting and it is cool, and kids want to know about the gross stuff. And it doesn't stop there with this guy. No, it carries on. And so, what we have next to show you is a video of the interesting diet of these animals and what happens after this diet gets processed. So, these guys are generally living in and around the coral reef. That's typically where they live, and that's a great shot right there. These are kind of humped. The beak is cool. They look a little goofy right there, kind of, you know, like little buck teeth sticking out. But these teeth are powerful. What they're eating is actually coral. Now, they don't want to eat the rock, but the rock is really hard. Coral is very, very tough, really hard. And what they're doing is they're trying to remove the polyps and the algae that live in and around that coral. So what they do is these guys are going around taking big bites out of the coral, and you can see it. If they just slice through it, like you biting into an apple, it is not that difficult for them. They will slice right through what is so tough, really like a rock. What happens is when they eat this, it's processing through, and this stuff is made out of calcium carbonate, which is kind of like little rocks, and we can see what happens here. That is then going to the bathroom. Their waste is actually sand. That's right. So when they eat rock, you poop sand. And this sand is so important. You might be thinking, this is disgusting. This is gross. They're just kind of, you know, they're making this sand out there. But one full-grown parrotfish, so important, can actually produce 1 ton of sand in about a year. And it's amazing because they build what we call the coral reefs and eventually the islands and sand. So when you're out there laying in the tropics, right, like Sarah and I have done in all of our awesome trips that we've been lucky enough to take, we're literally laying sometimes in parrotfish poop. But we love it.
Which may gross others out, but they just are biohazards. So that's cool. And there really is not dirty. And, you know, if you have the opportunity to visit a tropical island soon, don't be grossed out by this. It really is so important, you guys. They help build the sandy beach, and you wouldn't have a sandy beach to put your towel on to lay out to begin with. It would work for these animals. Now, of course, there are other processes that we talked about last week with David, build beaches. But some scientists say that up to 70% of the sand on given beaches can be from parrotfish. It's just phenomenal. It's really, really important. Annie, what is this fish called? The group of fishes is parrotfishes, and that guy specifically was a humphead parrotfish.
Yes,
right?
I think it was a humphead.
And so those are parrotfish, and one question that comes up a lot is what do we do at the aquarium before we quickly go through those other fish? Because we don't let them eat our hard coral, right? And so what do they eat?
Well, what we have is we call it live rock. And essentially what we've done is we have pieces of almost coral-like rock that has algae that we encourage the algae to grow. You know, go for it, algae gets a sunlight, grow on there. And we put it in the exhibit, and then we'll go through and munch on it. Now, it's important to do this for our animals, not only for their nutrition, but also to actually keep their beak or their teeth in line, otherwise it continues to go down. It actually also helps them to shave off and keep their teeth in line, so it's almost like, you know, it's like we are all little dentists for them.
It's like our orthodontics.
Yes.
Orthodontist. Okay, pufferfish, let's just show you some pictures of some pufferfish here as we move through. We have a starry puffer, different, and he's a true puffer, and then this guy's a porcupine puffer, and so clearly the difference. The next one you're going to see has spines all over his body, right? So those are the two big kinds of puffers.
Right, so spines or no spines, a lot of people can tell the difference too. You can see this guy's spines are laying flat, so it's difficult to tell sometimes. He is inflated, like we know from the movie again, Finding Nemo, but they can make a tank in water and actually expand themselves so their spines will stick out. The pufferfishes can also puff up, but they don't really have those spines, so it's porcupine fishes and pufferfishes.
And then we're going to skip to our temperate fish. Let's go ahead and show you a kelp fish. So one thing that is just fantastically beautiful here in Southern California are our kelp forests. And this animal in the background is perfect. Perfect at camouflaging in that kelp. And so explain to us his shape, right? Because he has a green nose, looks like the point of the blade or leaf.
Right. So he tries to camouflage with kelp, and he literally is shaped like a blade of kelp, which is really kind of interesting. But the other thing that is neat about him is he can actually also change color and camouflage himself to be kind of a bit of yellow or a little bit greener, a little bit darker, depending on the species, also male and female. Females can definitely change color a lot better than the males. I'm not exactly sure why. I don't know, Sarah, if you happen to know. But they're really interesting in that way. Also, they have modified pelvic fins so that they actually are able to grab onto the kelp and really beat in the kelp and look like a blade kelp just hiding in there.
So the camouflage world is not resigned to the tropical. We definitely have some creatures here in our temperate waters that are very, very good at it. So this will conclude our second class about fish, and I hope that everyone has learned a tremendous amount about fish and had a good time doing that as well. There will be a fish quiz that will appear tomorrow morning, so make sure to take that quiz. Again, if you're not on Blackboard, try and be patient. You will be by Monday. If you are not, you need to get in touch with Warren, and that email may appear here on the screen. Remind them not to worry. Yes, don't worry if you're not on Blackboard. Discussion board will also come up, you guys. Keep up with Blackboard. That's the best thing you can do in this class. Be proactive. Check on the announcements. Make sure that all of your assignments are up to date. There are also readings that you should be doing if you have your book already. In addition, you should be watching every single class. If you can't watch it live, you can watch it on archive. Every single class is absolutely necessary. Take care, guys. Have a really good week. We'll see you next week. Bye-bye.